兄弟姊妹早安。
Brothers, sisters, good morning.
主耶稣给门徒讲。
Our Lord said to his disciples,
在我的内面你有平安。
In me you have peace.
在世间你有苦难。
You have, in the world you have,
trouble. 你放心。
Take heart.
我已经赢过了这个世界。
Because I have overcome the world.
主耶稣怎样和安慰鼓励伊的门徒
？How the Lord comfort and strengthen his disciples？
和因平安，和因盼望
，to give them peace and hope。
今仔日主也是有缘，说伊要予咱平安，伊要予咱盼望。
The same way the Lord is telling us, I will give you peace and hope。
无论你现在的境界是甚么。
No matter what you are undergoing,
什么风浪
whether what trouble or,
主说你放心
the Lord says, take heart.
你有我的平安，你有我的盼望。
You have my peace, you have my hope.
所以兄弟姊妹，咱相信神的话。
Let us believe in His word, brothers and sisters.
对的话，咱会得到安慰。
Through His word, we will have comfort.
加着耶话，咱得到坚固。
Through His word, we will be encouraged.
因为咱知神是信实的。
Because we know that our Lord is faithful.
伊的确照顾了咱。
He will surely take care of us.
保守咱。
Preserve us.
所以兄弟姊妹，咱都继续读耶话，继续顽服思想耶话。
Brothers and sisters, let us continue to read His word and dwell upon Him.Upon this word.
求主祝福咱。
May the Lord bless us.
Love was when God became a man, locked in time and space without place. Love was God born in Bethlehem, just a carpenter with some fishermen. Love was when Jesus walked in history.Lovingly He brought a new life that's free. Love was God nailed to bleed and die to reach and love one such as I.When God became a man, down where I could see love that reached to me, love was God dying for my sin, and so trapped was I.Jesus met me, now it's real. Lovingly He came, I can feel He's real. Feel He's real, know He's real. I know He's real, He's real. Love was God, only He would try.Such as I would
Some churches celebrate Christmas while others don't. Those who do and those who do not, they have a variety of reasons for their decisions. Now, both sides have also a few arguments against what the other side believes. Now, this morning, we are not going to talk about these things because doing so is not helpful at all. It will just divide the body of Christ and give the devil a foothold. The desire of our Lord is for all of us, His followers, to be united, to be one, just as He and the Father is one. And so instead of talking about the merits or demerits of celebrating Christmas, we are going to talk about something that churches on both sides of the fence agree on: the fact that Jesus Christ came into the world as a gift of God. John chapter 3 verse 16 is a verse that we all believe in and we all accept it as true. It says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, which is Jesus Christ." God gave His Son as a gift to us. 1 John chapter 4 verse 9 says, "This is how God shows His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him." He sent His one and only Son into the world as a gift to us that we might live through Him. And then in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 15, as the Apostle Paul was writing to the believers in Corinth, he described this gift, which is Jesus Christ, as an extraordinary gift. A gift that is too amazing, too wonderful for words to describe. And Paul says, "Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift." Indescribable gift. Now this morning, I'm inviting you to spend a few moments to think with me about Jesus, the gift that God has given us on that special night 2,000 years ago. In particular, we will think of why Paul called this gift, you know, the indescribable gift. As a result, I hope that we will all learn to appreciate the gift as well as the giver. I hope that in return, we will also worship the gift, the giver, as well as the gift, the amazing gift, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now, if we think deeply about why Jesus was called the indescribable gift, we can think of many reasons. But this morning, I would like to just point out four of these reasons for us to think and to consider. Why was Jesus called the indescribable gift? Number one, this gift is an indescribable gift because God is the giver of the gift. God is the source of the gift. You know, some years back, my wife and I, we were helping a church in the province. Now, while there, someone gave me a nice looking coffee mug. Now, one that has the name and the logo of the organization that he works with. You know, I was so happy to receive this mug. However, on the last day, as we were packing our things, I had a dilemma. I wanted to bring the mug home, but our luggage has weight limitations. Those of you who have taken Cebu Pacific, you know what I mean. And the mug did not come with a box or with a bubble pack, so that there was a risk if I, you know, just pack it in. So for several minutes, I struggled on whether to bring the mug home or not. It was a gift from a Christian leader. It was a souvenir from one of my ministry trips, so I wanted to bring it home. However, if I decide to bring it home, I had to hand carry it, which will be quite inconvenient for me. Not only that, since I am not a mug collector, I know that probably a few years later after I bring it home, I would eventually give it away or probably even throw it away. Today, I am not going to tell you whether I did bring the mug home or not. I'll just leave that to your imagination. But I would like to tell you that that incident sets me thinking. As I look back to my struggle that day, I thought that the story would be totally different if the mug, you know, were a gift from someone important, say the King of Thailand or the President of the US, or if it was a gift from someone that I admire, you know, probably Pastor Chuck Swindoll or the late architect IMP. I don't think I will ever receive a mug from any of these people. But if I do, I will most likely put that mug in our living room showcase where our family albums are and where the other treasured items are stored. I will not just put the mug there, I will also lock it up. And I will instruct everyone at home to take good care of it. From time to time, I will probably take it out. I will clean it. I will buff it. I will, you know, dust it and with much care. And most likely, I will keep that mug for many years. And every time I have a visitor, I will show it to them and will proudly tell them how I came to have that gift. Why? Because the gift is not an ordinary gift. It is a gift, you know, from a VIP, from someone very special. In the passage that we are studying today, which is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15, Paul says that we have a gift which is from God, and that gift is, he said, is an indescribable gift. Now, you have to understand that in the preceding passage, Paul was reminding his readers about the collection for the poor Christians in Jerusalem. He was encouraging them, you know, to give as they had pledged to do so, saying that if they deliver on their promise to give, others will thank God because of them, because of what they do. And then suddenly, as he was thinking about the gift that the Corinthian believers had promised to give, he burst out in thanksgiving. He thanked God for giving us his gift. Paul burst out in thanksgiving because he was amazed why God, the sovereign creator of everything, would ever think of giving a gift to men, and particularly to him. He burst out in thanksgiving because he realized that God did keep his promise. He did fulfill his promise to send a redeemer to redeem all of us from sin. He also burst out in thanksgiving because he could not understand why God can be so gracious to us, we who are unworthy sinners. The words "thanks be to God" that he used in Greek actually expresses amazement. And that phrase can be translated as, "Oh, how gracious is God. Look, the graciousness of God." Jesus Christ is a gift from God, a gracious gift from God, from the sovereign creator of the universe. Paul called this gift an indescribable gift because it did not come from a mere mortal. It was not a birthday gift from a friend. It was not a Thanksgiving gift that, you know, his employer gives him at the end of a good business year. It was not a surprise gift that his parents or spouse, you know, give out of their affection, out of their love for him. The gift was not, you know, bought from 168 or SM or Rustan or Lazada or Shopee. You know, it is not a gift that came from New York's Fifth Avenue or Hollywood or Disneyland. It is also not a gift, you know, that a friend brought home, you know, while from a cruise trip or while touring Italy or France. This gift is a gift from heaven. It is a gift that comes from God, the awesome, glorious, majestic Creator, sovereign Lord of everything. It is a gift from someone, the God who is almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing. And that God gave us his Son out of his love for us. None of us deserve any gift from God, but yet out of his deep love, out of his generous love for us, he gave us his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. As such, this gift is indeed an indescribable gift. Now, there's a second reason why Paul called this gift an indescribable gift. This gift is an indescribable gift because God's own Son is the gift. God's own Son is the gift. You know, as Paul was thinking about God, His faithfulness, His love, His graciousness that caused Him to give us a gift, Paul turned his eyes, you know, upon the gift and said, wow, this is indescribable. The word indescribable means this is something that cannot be thoroughly understood, comprehended. It is something that is inexpressible, something that cannot be fully explained. Think of this for a moment. The gift that God gave us was not just an expensive and beautiful coffee mug or a keychain or a ball pen. It was not, you know, just an expensive t-shirt or a handbag or a cell phone. It was not even, you know, just a top-of-the-line laptop, a fast and expensive sports car, or a big house and lot. The gift that God gave us was His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, a gift that is truly inexplicable, you know, an expression or an act that is truly incomprehensible. I don't believe that any of you in your right mind would ever give away your children unless you have an extreme or special reason to do so. Regardless of whether you have 2 or 4 or 6 or 8 children, I believe that none of you will ever wrap up your child and then give it to someone, not even to your BFF. You would probably be willing to buy your friend a good and expensive gift. You would probably be willing to give away something that is valuable to someone that you love dearly. You would probably be even willing to give all that you have, you know, all the money that you have, to someone that is particularly close to your heart. But I doubt if you would ever be willing to give away your son or your daughter, even if you have a dozen of them. But listen to what the Apostle John has to say regarding the gift that God has given us. He said, "For God so loved the world, because He loved the world, He gave His one and only Son." How in the world will you ever describe such a gift? Jesus is God's Son, and God gave Him away. He is not only, you know, the Son of God, but He is, you know, God Himself, as the Bible had told us. He is the eternal God who became a man and who was born in a manger. And He was given to me, He was given to you, people who are sinful and rebellious. Think further. Jesus is God, the God that the angels of heaven worship. He is the God by whom, through whom, and for whom all things were created. He is the God, you know, that all creatures in heaven and on earth will one day bow down and worship as Lord, as King. But yet, because of the Father's love, He was sent as a gift to everyone who is willing to receive it. How would you describe such a gift? What words will you use to describe this kind of a gift? Paul says that we can never describe that gift, and he is right. Many of the wisest men in the world have tried to describe Jesus, but none has ever described Him fully. You know, creeds and doctrines have been written to describe Him, but none have ever been adequate. Poets, musicians, writers, theologians, all have tried to encapsulate God's giving of His Son in words and in songs, but none has ever been enough nor satisfactory. Today, we ought to be thankful because God, in His great love, He gave us an indescribable gift, Jesus, His one and only Son. Now, there's a third reason why this gift is called an indescribable gift. It is an indescribable gift because it brings us reconciliation and peace. This is an indescribable gift because it brings us reconciliation with God, peace with God, and peace with men. You know, in the previous chapter, in verse 9 of that chapter, Paul wrote, "For you know the grace of the Lord of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich." Today, the proponents of prosperity gospel, they are wrongly using this verse to say that Jesus, you know, he became poor so that we can be rich and prosperous materially. But Paul was not talking about material wealth when he said that Jesus became poor so that we can be rich. Instead, Paul was talking about the spiritual richness that we can have in Jesus Christ. He was talking about the richness of love, the richness of joy that we can have when we are reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. And in particular, he was talking about the richness of peace that we can have when we are reconciled with God. You know, we will have peace with him. We will have peace with men when our sins are forgiven because of Jesus Christ. So when Paul called this gift an indescribable gift, you know, in this next chapter, it is apparent that he was thinking not just of the source of the gift. He was not just thinking of the gift itself. Paul was also thinking about the result, the purpose, the outcome of the gift. That is why he said, "Thank God for this indescribable gift." As we all know, when Jesus was born, God sent angels, you know, to announce his birth, you know, to a group of shepherds. And in their announcement, the angels told them the purpose, the reason why God was giving his son. The angel said, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, you know, who is Christ the Lord." And then they said, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men. Peace to men on whom his favor rests." And so from here we can see that the purpose, the reason why God gave us this gift is to give us peace through our reconciliation with God. We are sinners, and because of our sins, we became, you know, the enemies of God. However, God in his love, he found a way, he created a way so that we can be reconciled again. And the angels said that Jesus was born as a Savior, and his birth was meant to bring peace to mankind. Peace with God and peace with one another. You know, in the past few years, I have been teaching the book of Revelations, both in our church and in other places. And I have discovered that between now and the end of the world, peace is what the world will be longing for, is what the world will be fighting for. Peace, or the search for peace, will also be the reason why the leaders of the world, you know, will one day willingly allow the Antichrist to rule the whole world. When the Soviet Union broke up and communism collapsed, people thought that peace would finally, you know, come to the world. When the wall of Berlin was pulled down, the world thought that peace would finally reign, you know, in Europe and in other places. When Saddam Hussein was arrested and Iraq was liberated from his regime, many Iraqis and Arabs and even Americans thought that peace would reign in that part of the world. When Marcos was toppled, many Filipinos thought that there will now be peace in our land. But peace did not come with these downfalls. Instead, we continue to hear of wars, of rumors of wars, of unrests. Despite the many peace treaties that have been signed and the many rules and laws that have been enacted, peace is still as elusive as before. Why is this so? This is so because of our human nature. Our human nature has not changed and has not been changed. Selfishness continues to reign in our hearts. Greed, lust, pride continue, you know, to reign in our hearts. Men are still enslaved by sin, by their sinful nature, by their self-centeredness. God knew all about this from the very day that Adam and Eve sinned. So when God looked at us, when God looked at the world, He knew that our greatest need is not more money, it is not better schools, it is not even, you know, better political system. He saw that what we need is a reconciliation with Him. Our greatest need is a Savior who will save us from our sin, who will reconcile us back to God, and bring us lasting peace, peace that comes from inside out. That was why when He gave His one and only Son, the angels announced peace on earth. Jesus Christ came to destroy sin and to free us from bondage. Jesus Christ came to give us a new life. And because of that new life, which comes from above, which comes from God, we will be able to overcome sin and selfishness and greed and lust and pride and all these things. And once we have that new life, we will have peace. First, we'll have peace with God, and then we will be able to live peaceably with men, with other people, and even with ourselves. So isn't that, you know, an indescribable, amazing gift? How in the world would you describe such a gift? How in the world would you put into words what God has accomplished when He sent His one and only Son into this world? Now, there's one more reason why, you know, the gift that God gave us is indescribable. This gift is indescribable because the gift is undeserved. We are undeserving of the gift. We have no claim, you know, to that gift. You know, most of the gifts that we give to others are given because the recipients, you know, have some claim on us. I know that some of you might disagree with me, but that is the truth. It is an open secret that most of us know, but we do not like to talk about. Think about this. Why do you give gifts to your wife? Well, you may say, I love my wife. Well, that's true. But at the end, you know, at the back of it, you give gifts to her because she has a claim on you. She is your wife. Your marital relationship to her, her marital relationship to you, you know, laid a claim on you. Why do you give gifts to your children? Again, it's all because they have a claim on you. They are your children. Their offspring relationship to you laid a claim on you. Why do you give your gifts to your friends and relatives? Well, you give gifts for the same reason. You give them gifts probably because they gave you one last year, and you feel obligated to return their favor. You know, many Chinese, we do that. And their precious gift, their previous gift rather, laid a claim on us. You give them gifts probably because through the years they have been good to you and you feel that you have to repay them. Their goodness laid a claim on you. You give them gifts probably because they are in some ways related to you. A boss, you know, an uncle, you know, an auntie, their position and their honor laid a claim on you. Now, I know that some of you would ask, how about the gifts that we give to those who are poor during the pandemic? The orphans or the street children or even to the frontliners. Well, you may not realize this, but you also give gifts to these people because they have a claim on you. You give them because deep within you, you recognize that you owe them or you owe humanity a debt. You give them gifts because some way, somehow, you know that you owe these people a debt of love and you are obligated to do something for them in return. And so your obligation or your debt laid a claim on you. So whether you admit it or not, we give gifts because the recipients of our gift have some claims on us. And that is what makes God's gift so special. God does not owe us anything. He is not obligated to give us anything. And He is not required to give us a gift, much more, you know, the gift of His one and only Son. Remember, He is God. He is the supreme ruler of the universe. He is the Almighty, the Infinite, the Sovereign God. He is perfect in power, perfect in wisdom, perfect in all things. He sits on the throne. On top of that, He is holy. We are sinful. As His creatures, originally, we have a claim on Him because He created us. However, because of sin, because we have sinned, and we constantly continue to sin, we constantly reject Him. We constantly choose to go our own way. We constantly disobey Him. We constantly rebel against Him. And because of that, we have no claim at all. However, despite His our unfaithfulness, He remains faithful to us. Despite, you know, our lack of goodness to Him, He continues to be good to us. We have forfeited all claims on Him. He is not obligated to take care of us, to be concerned of us, but yet, in His love, He gave us His one and only Son, Jesus Christ. God gave Jesus to us not because He is obligated, but because, nor because we have a right to that gift. Instead, He gave us Jesus because of His great and overwhelming love for us. And so today, we have to respond, you know, just like what the psalmist did in Psalm chapter 8, verse 4. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? Just like the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, we have to think, we have to understand that God demonstrates His love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Such love is incomprehensible. It is beyond description. It is beyond, you know, comprehension. Because of that, Jesus is aptly called God's indescribable gift to us. Now, this morning, I hope that every one of us have already received this indescribable gift that God gives to us. If you have not yet received it today, at this moment, you may receive Him into your heart by faith. Acknowledge that you are a sinner who needs God's forgiveness, who needs to be reconciled to God. Acknowledge, too, that Jesus can forgive you of your sins, and then receive Him into your heart, receive Him into your life. If you do so, you will receive the best gift that you will ever receive in your life. Now, for those of you who have already received that gift from God, we now have an obligation, and that obligation is to tell others about that gift, and also an obligation to share that gift with them. We have to show them through our life the value, the importance of having that gift. And then through our words, we need to tell them about Jesus Christ, the greatest gift of all, God's indescribable gift to mankind. And so this morning, whether you celebrate Christmas or not, that is not important. What is important is, do you have you received that gift into your life? Are you sharing that gift to other people? I hope that we will think through all of this, you know, in the remaining days of this year, and that in the end, we will come to acknowledge not just, you know, the wonderful gift of Jesus Christ, but we will truly accept Him into your life, this indescribable gift, and that we will live Him out and share Him with other people. Thank you, and may God bless you through the rest of the year, and as well through the new year. May you all have a blessed, joyful, fruitful year ahead. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for joining our online worship service. We have some announcements for the week. We invite you to join our Friday night service. Let us pause from this holiday season's busyness and remember it's all about the cross. Are you convinced that God will always do what He says and fulfill His promises? Next Lord's Day, let us listen to Brother Jackson as he shares with us the message about God's great faithfulness. You are welcome to attend CGCQC Sunday School classes. Here is the list of meeting times. Please contact our teachers for access to their Zoom or Messenger calls. When we gather with other believers to pray, we can encourage one another and build one another up. Join our prayer meetings online. Please arrange with your care groups your virtual prayer time weekly. Let's offer our tithes as worship unto the Lord. Should you want to make an offering, online giving is now available. Here are our bank account details for your reference. Let us continue to persevere in faithfulness by God's grace. God bless and stay safe.